Scheherazade. In the history of Sasanians, the king of Persia, there was once a very famous king. He was loved by all his people because he was so intelligent and kind, and feared by all his neighbors because of his courage and strength in war. This king had two sons who were like their father, wise and strong. After many years, the king died. According to custom, his oldest son, Shahryar, became king. The younger son, Shahzman, was very happy for his brother and not at all jealous. So when Shahryar gave him the kingdom of Great Tartary, he went there happily to become its king. After many years, Shahryar wanted to see his brother and sent for him. Shahzman left the city with much music and happiness. However, the first night he missed his wife, whom he loved very much. So he decided to go back to see her once more. When he returned, he found his wife with others planning to kill him. In anger, he killed them all. Then, very saddened, he continued his journey. Near his brother's kingdom, he was met by the king and his people. The king was very happy to see his brother and entertained him with huge banquets, music, and dancing. But Shahzman was very sad and could not eat or sleep well. Finally, one day the king asked him to go hunting with him. Shahzman refused, saying he was ill. Alone in his room, he heard his brother's wife and friends planning to murder Shahryar. Shahzman was very upset and began to think of how bad all women were. Since he was not the only one with this kind of problem, he decided he should not worry about it. From then on, he began to eat well and be happy again. When Shahryar returned from the hunt, he found his brother recovered. The king felt relief. After promising to thank heaven, he asked his brother about the cause of his sadness. Shahzman was very troubled and did not want to answer. But the king insisted. Finally, Shahzman told his brother the story of his return to see his wife and how he found her planning to kill him. Upon hearing this, the king was very angry and told his brother, "What a terrible thing! You were right to kill them. What has made you feel better?" This time, Shahzman was really troubled and tried many ways to avoid answering. Finally, however, he had no choice, so he told Shahryar about hearing his wife also planning to kill him. "It was strange," explained Shahzman, "but hearing this had made him feel better." Because he was not the only one with a problem with women, he had decided that he should not feel so sorry for himself. And hearing this story, Shahryar became very angry and ordered his wife and her partners killed. This he did. Every night he married a new woman, every morning she was killed. The sound of parents crying over the death of their daughters could be heard everywhere. Soon the people began to hate the king they once loved. The king's servant, the grand vizier, had to do the killing. He himself had two very beautiful and intelligent daughters, the oldest called Scheherazade and the youngest Dinarzade. One day, the oldest daughter, Scheherazade, said to her father, "I would like you to help me so that I can stop this terrible killing. I want you to give me to the king for a wife." The grand vizier was very surprised and angry. "Why do you ask me to do such a thing? Don't you know that you will be killed?" "Maybe," she replied, "but I must try to stop this killing. If he won't help me, I'll give myself to him anyway." Having no choice, the grand vizier offered his daughter to Shahryar. The king was very surprised and told him, "Do not be mistaken. You will have to kill your own daughter or else be killed yourself." Scheherazade had a plan. Before she went to marry the king, she told her sister what to do. Then she went to the king. When the king saw her, she found her crying and asked her what was wrong. "I'm sad at having to leave my sister. I love her very much. Could I please see her one last time?" she asked. The king having agreed, Dinarzade came the next morning. As they had planned, Dinarzade asked her sister to tell her one last story. Scheherazade asked the king if this would be all right. When he agreed, she began to tell them the following story. The Merchant and the Genie. One day, a merchant decided to rest on his trip. Sitting by a tree, he ate some fruit and threw the seeds on the ground. After finishing his meal, he suddenly saw a large, angry genie come towards him. "Stand so that I can kill you," shouted the genie. "You killed my son." "But I don't even know your son," replied the frightened merchant. "Didn't you throw seeds just now?" the genie asked. "One of them hit my son in the eye and killed him, so I must kill you." Here, Scheherazade stopped her story because it was morning, and the king had to say his prayers. "The end of the story is even more surprising," she said to him. "If you let me live one more day, I will tell it to you." The king agreed to let her live until she finished the story. He spent that night with her and then the next morning asked her to continue the story. So she continued. When the merchant saw the genie was going to kill him, he cried, "Please give me 1 year to say goodbye to my family. I promise to meet you here 1 year from today." The genie agreed to this and left. A year later, the merchant went to meet the genie. While waiting for him, an old man with a horse came by and asked what he was doing there. After the merchant told him his story, the old man thought it very unusual and decided to stay and see what happened. A little later, another old man came by with two dogs. He too decided to stay after hearing the story. The genie arrived shortly and went straight to the merchant and said, "Get up, so I can kill you." Just as he was about to kill the merchant, the old man with the horse said, "Please wait and listen to my story. If you think it is a good story, I hope you will forgive the merchant half his mistake." The genie thought for a few minutes, but finally agreed. The old man then began saying, "This horse you see is my wife, with whom I lived for 20 years without children. Because I wanted children, I took the son of a slave as my son. My wife was very jealous and hated them both. Once, when I went on a long journey, my wife studied magic. She then changed the boy into a tiny calf and the mother into a cow. When I returned, she told me the slave was dead and my son had not been seen for months. The time of the festival arrived and I sent for a cow to be killed for the gods. But when I was going to kill her, she made sounds like she was crying, so I stopped. My wife insisted, however, so I had somebody else kill her. Strangely, the cow turned out to be only bones, so I sent for another one. I was brought a very young calf who ran to me and put his head to the ground at my feet. I felt very sorry for him and refused to kill him, even though my wife insisted. The next day, the daughter of my servant told me about what happened while I was gone. She said she could not do anything for the slave who had been killed as a cow. But she could make my son a man again. She would do so if she could marry him and punish my wife. Then I agreed. She said some magical words and made my son a man again. Then she turned my wife into a horse. Is this not a strange story?" "Yes, it is," said the genie. "So I will pardon him half of his mistake." Then the second man said, "I too have an interesting story. Please listen to it, and if you think it better than the story you just heard, pardon him the second half of his mistake." Then he began his story. "These two dogs and I are brothers. When our father died, he left each of us 1,000 pieces of gold. I made a lot of money, but my brothers lost everything. So I gave them more money. My brothers wanted me to be their partners and go on a journey. We then sailed to another land where I made a lot of money, but my brothers lost all of theirs. As we were about to leave, a poor woman came up to me and asked that I marry her. She kept asking until finally I agreed. Later, I came to love her very much. Meanwhile, my brothers have made a plan to kill me and take my money. One night, they threw me and my wife into the sea. But my wife saved me. She carried me to an island where she told me she was really a fairy. She had wanted to test my goodness. Since I was good to her, she saved me. But my brothers would have to die," she said. I thanked her for saving me, but begged her to forgive my brothers. She then sent me back to my home, where I found these two dogs. The fairy then came and told me they were my brothers and that she had changed them into dogs for 5 years. After that, I must find her to change them back. So now I am looking for her. Isn't this a true strange story? Yes, I must agree that it is, and so I will not kill this merchant, said the genie, who then flew away. The merchant thanked the old man again and again before they all went their own ways. The Fisherman and the Genie. There was once an old fisherman who was very poor. One day while fishing, he pulled in his nets and found a copper jar. Because he was very curious, he decided to open it and see what was inside. Suddenly, black smoke rose from the jar into the air. The fisherman was very frightened, especially when the smoke became a genie who said to him, "Prepare to die, because I'm going to kill you." "But why kill me? Did I not just let you out? Have you so soon forgotten my kindness?" he asked. "No, but I must kill you anyway. During the first 100 years that I was in there, I would have made anybody rich who let me out. During the next 100, I would have given him all the money in the world. In the 300, I would have made him a king. But finally, I got so mad, I decided to kill whoever let me out for not doing it sooner. So you must die." The fisherman quickly thought of a plan. "Before I die, please tell me one thing. You're very big. Were you really in that small jar? I can't believe it unless you prove it." So the genie became smoke and went back into the jar. The fisherman quickly closed it. "Now I will never let you out and will tell all the other people about you," said the fisherman. "Please let me out and I will make you rich," cried the genie. "If I was such a fool, I should die. You will do the same to me as the king of Greece did to Duban." Indeed, you should listen to the story. The King and the Doctor. There was once a king who was very sick. No doctor could help him. But one day, a doctor named Duban came. "I can make you healthy again, dear king," he said. "If you can do as you say, I will make you rich," promised the king. The doctor made the king well. He received many thanks and much money from the king. But the king had some people who were jealous of Duban. They told him that Duban wanted to kill him. At first, the king would not believe them, but finally he agreed. So he ordered Duban killed. Duban was, of course, very surprised and said, "But king, have you forgotten that I saved you? Surely you do not believe the story of these jealous men." But the king would not listen and ordered him killed. First, he let Duban go home to say goodbye to his wife and to get his books for the king. When Duban came back, he asked for a plate. He then put a book on the plate and said to the king, "As soon as my head is cut off, put it on this plate and the blood will stop. When open the book, and the head will answer your questions." When Duban's head was cut off and put on the plate, the blood stopped and the eyes opened and it said, "Please open the book and read." But when the king opened the book, he found nothing written. "Turn some more pages," said Duban. So the king, wetting his fingers by putting them in his mouth, turned many pages. Suddenly, he became very ill because the pages had poison on them. Before he died, Duban said to him, "This will teach you to be bad to those who help you." When the fisherman finished his story, he said to the genie, "You are like the king. If you had been good to those who helped you, you would still be free. But if you let me go, this time I promised to make you rich." The fisherman was very poor, so he decided to let him go. When the genie was freed, he told the fisherman, "Go to the lake over this mountain. There you can catch some very unusual fish. There are 4 different colored fish there. Take one of each to the king, and he will make you rich." Having said this, he flew away into the sky. The Story of Magical Horse. The king of Persia was having a big festival when a Hindu came by with a horse of wood. He said to the king, "This is a magical horse. It can fly anywhere you want. If you would like, I'll show you. He then got on the horse and flew very fast to the mountain nearby and back. The king was very surprised and asked the Hindu to sell him the horse. To this, the Hindu answered, I'll let you have the horse only if you give your daughter to me for a wife. The son of the king, the prince, was very angry when he heard this. You cannot give the princess to a man like this, he said. I'll not give him the princess, but I might give him something else. First, however, you should try the horse yourself, answered the king. So, without waiting for the Hindu to tell him how to fly the horse, the prince jumped on and flew away. He flew so fast that he became afraid. He then tried to stop, but found out that he did not know how. The king was also very frightened for his son and very angry with the Hindu for causing this trouble. He ordered the Hindu to be taken away. If in 3 months the prince was not back, the Hindu would be killed. Meanwhile, the prince had found out how to stop the horse. He came down in Bengal, far from his home. Going into a house nearby, he saw a beautiful woman sleeping. He told her he was the prince of Persia and asked her to help him. She promised to do so. After a short time, the prince wanted to return home. But when he told this to the princess, she would not let him, asking him to stay a little longer. This continued for 2 months until the prince said he had to go home to see his father. But before going, he asked the princess to marry him. She and her father both agreed, and soon the two young lovers got on the horse and flew back to Persia. Before entering the city, the prince decided he should first ask his father about the marriage. He left the princess in a nearby summer home of the king, promising to come back for her soon. The king was very happy to see his son. He agreed to the marriage, saying they would go the same day to bring the princess back. He also ordered the Hindu to be freed. Having done so, they went to get the princess. The Hindu, who was very angry, heard of the marriage and flew on his horse to where the princess was waiting. He told her that the king had sent him for her, so she should come with him on the horse. But the Hindu flew over the heads of the king and prince to show them the princess he had taken. Then he flew away. The king and the prince were very sad. The prince decided to look for the princess until he found her or died. So he began to walk all over the country dressed as a poor man. The Hindu, meanwhile, tried to make the princess marry him, but she would not. He became angry and started to hit her. A man who was walking by heard the princess call for help. Seeing how beautiful she was, he decided the Hindu must be a bad man and killed him. But the princess was not safe yet. The man was the king of the Kashmir, and he too wanted to marry the princess. When she found this out, she decided to pretend to be crazy. The king was very upset and asked many doctors to help her. But of course, they could do nothing. The prince, having heard the story about a princess of Bengal who had gone crazy on her wedding night in Kashmir, felt sure it was his love. He went there quickly, pretending to be a doctor. He met the king and promised him he would make the princess well if he could meet her alone. When the princess saw a doctor coming, she again pretended to be crazy. But when she heard the prince speak, she knew her lover had come. Together, they made a plan. The prince went to the king and asked him how the princess had come to Kashmir. The king told him about the horse. The prince then told the king to bring the horse the next day. He should also have the princess wear the most beautiful jewels that the king had. Then he would make her well. The next day, the horse was brought. After they got on the horse, the prince suddenly made it fly into the sky. When he was far away, he yelled to the king, Next time, you should not try to marry someone who does not want to marry you. He then returned home where he and the princess were married that same day. The Story of the Three Sisters. There was once a king who, dressed in the clothes of a poor man, used to walk through his city. One day, he heard loud voices. Going closer, he saw three sisters. The oldest one was saying, "My wish is to marry the king's baker. Then I could eat delicious bread every day." The second sister said, "I wish to marry the king's cook. Then I could eat many delicious food, so my wish is better than yours." The youngest daughter was the most beautiful and intelligent of all. She said, "My wish is even better. I wish to marry the king." The king thought the wishes very unusual, so he decided to make them come true. The next day, having sent for the three sisters, he asked them to tell him the wishes they had made the night before. But the sisters were afraid that he would be angry, so they did not say anything. The king understood this, so he said, "Do not be afraid. I agree to your wishes. You shall each marry the man you wished for." After the weddings, the older sisters became jealous of their sister, who had a much better life. But they did not show their jealousy. Then one day, the queen had a baby boy. The sisters, however, put him in a basket and threw him in the river. They then told the king that the baby was just a dog. This made the king very angry at the queen. Meanwhile, the basket with the little prince was found by the king's servant. Since he had no children, he took the baby as his own. The next year, the queen had another baby boy. Again, the sisters put him in a basket and threw him in the river. They told the king it was only a cat. The same servant again found the basket and took the baby as his own. The next year, the queen had another baby, this time a girl. Again, the sisters threw it in the river, telling the king it was only a stick of wood. The same servant found her and again took her as his daughter. This time, the king was very angry. He put the queen in prison. Meanwhile, the two princes and the princess grew up with the servant and his wife. They were very intelligent and good children. When they were old enough, the princess began their studies. Since the princess also wanted to study, she did too. She often did better than her brothers, even in sports. The servant was very happy with his children, so he built them a beautiful house in the country. But shortly after it was finished, the servant died. The three lived very well for some time. Then one day, an old woman came by. The princess asked her to come in for dinner. After talking of many things, the princess asked her if she liked their houses. The old woman said it was very nice, but it needed three things. The princess was very surprised and asked what these things were. "The first thing is a speaking bird. The next is a singing tree, and the last is a magical yellow water," answered the old woman. She then told her, "To find them, one must walk 20 days and then ask the first person he meets where they are." After saying this, she laughed. When the princess told her brothers this story, the oldest decided he would go look for these unusual things. But as he was leaving the next day, the princess asked him not to go because she was afraid it might be dangerous. The prince told her not to worry and gave her a special knife. If the prince was killed, the knife would turn red with blood. After giving it to her, he left. On the 20th day, he asked the first person he met about the strange things. This person said, "I know where these things are, but I hope you do not try to get them. Many young men have died doing so. Please listen to me and go back home." The prince would not listen, though, so the man told him, "Take this ball and throw it in front of you. Where it stops, you will see many black stones. They are the young men who have died before you. You must go straight up the mountain. There will be many loud voices trying to make you afraid. If you look either right or left, you too will become a black stone. If you can make it to the top of the mountain, you will find the speaking bird, and he will tell you where to find the others." The prince then went ahead, even though the man again asked him not to. After throwing the ball in front of him, he soon came to the mountain. When he began to climb up, he heard some terrible voices. "Kill him! Kill him!" they shouted. The prince did not look, though, and continued to walk straight ahead. Finally, the voices became so loud, he forgot the words of the man and looked behind him. He immediately became a stone. At the same time, the princess looked at the knife. It was red with blood. She knew her brother was dead. She was very sad and wished she had never listened to the stories of the old lady. Her brother then decided he would go look for the strange things. Not listening to his sister, who begged him not to go, he too left. But before going, he gave his sister a pearl necklace. He told her that if the pearls did not move on the string, then he too was dead. On the 20th day, he met the same man and was told the same things as his brother. But he too decided to go on anyway. He had not gone more than 5 steps up the mountain when he heard something that made him angry. Forgetting the words of the man, he too turned his head to look back and was immediately changed into a stone. The princess tried to move her pearls and couldn't. She knew her brother was dead. She had already decided to go herself if her brother did not succeed. She immediately left and 20 days later met the same man. After he told her about her brothers and the dangers, the princess asked him if she could cover her ears so that she wouldn't hear the voices and become afraid. He told her she could try this if she wanted. So the princess covered her ears so that she was not frightened by the voices. She made it all the way to the top on the mountain. She then took the bird. At the same time, the voices stopped. The bird said to her, "Princess, I'd rather be yours than anyone else's. I know who you are, for you're not who you think, and I will someday tell you more." The princess then asked about the singing tree and the yellow water. When the bird told her where these things could be found, she went and got them. She then asked the bird how she could change her brother's back. The bird did not want to say, but finally he told her that she had to put water on the stones as she walked down the mountain and they would all become men again. The princess did as she was told and changed all the stones back into men. She was very happy to see her brothers and they to see her. They went happily back to their home, taking with them the speaking bird, the singing tree, and the yellow water. After a few days, the princess went hunting. Along the way, they met the king by accident. They fell to the ground to greet him, but he told them to stand. He asked them to come to his palace, but the princess refused, saying they had to go home because their sister was waiting for them. The king was very surprised, but not angry. He asked them to meet him the next day to go hunting. Again, the king asked them to come to his palace, but they'd forgotten to tell their sister, so again they said they could not go with the king. Again, he was not angry, but he gave them 3 gold balls. If they forgot to tell their sister again, when they got undressed at night, the balls would fall out and make a noise. Then they would remember to tell her. This is just what happened. When they heard the gold balls, they remembered to tell their sister what had happened. The princess was very surprised and said they should ask the bird what to do in this very important situation. The bird told them they should go with the king and then later ask him to come to their house. This is just what they did. The king agreed to come to their house the next day. When the princess heard that the king was coming, she again went to the bird to ask about what to make for dinner. The bird told her to make a very unusual dish, cucumbers with pearls in the middle. The princess was very surprised and said she did not have enough pearls. But the bird told her where she could find some. So the princess looked where she was told. She found many pearls and gave them to her cook, telling him to make the dish. The next day, the king came. When he saw the princess, he thought she was very beautiful, so beautiful that she could even be his daughter. After a while, they went into a garden. The king asked the princess where the beautiful music was coming from. She showed him the singing tree. The king was very surprised and asked her where she had found a tree like this. The princess told him that she had found it with the yellow water and the speaking bird. She would show him those two after he rested. But the king wanted to see them right away, so the princess first took him to see the magical yellow water that never stopped running. The king thought it very beautiful and looked at it for a long time. Then the princess showed him the speaking bird. The bird greeted him, saying, "Long live the king!" As they sat down to eat at the table next to the bird, the king said to him, "Bird, I thank you. I'm glad to have met the king of birds." When the king saw the cucumbers, he took one and was going to eat it when he found the pearls inside. Surprised, he asked them why they had done this. But the bird suddenly said, "How can the king be so surprised at pearls and cucumbers when he can believe that the queen has the mother of a dog, a cat, and a stick?" "I believe those things because my servants told me so," answered the king. "Those servants were the jealous sisters of the queen and said those things to make you angry with her," said the bird. "The two princes are your sons and the princess is your daughter." "Bird, I believe what you say is true," the king said. He then kissed his children, very surprised and happy to have found them. After dinner, the king went back and first ordered the two sisters killed. Then he went to the queen and, with tears in his eyes, begged her to forgive him. The next day, the queen, the princess, and the princess came riding into town together with the king. Everybody came to see the beautiful young princess and the handsome princess and also see the bird that flew nearby. All night long, there were happy parties throughout the land. The Story of Sinbad the Sailor. There was once a poor man named Hindbad, who one day, being very tired from hard work, stopped to rest. He happened to stop in front of the house of a very rich man, Sinbad the Sailor. Hindbad did not know him, so he wondered how Sinbad was so different from him that he should have so much money. Sinbad heard him and asked him to come and have dinner with him and listen to the story of how he became so rich. The story was as follows. The Fourth Voyage. When I was a young man, my father gave me a lot of money, but I soon spent it all and had to make a voyage to make some more. One day, we came to an island where some of us went ashore. Suddenly, the island began to move. It was not a real island, but the back of a sea monster. The captain of the ship had to leave quickly, so many of the monsters were killed. However, I caught a piece of wood, and I was able to get to an island after a few days. On the island, I was surprised to meet someone who spoke my language. He took me to his king. After hearing my story and asking me many questions about my country, the king was very good to me. Finally, I had to go back and went to look for a ship. That day, by chance, my old ship arrived. So taking my goods, I gave them to the king in thanks. But he gave me many much more expensive things in return. I then sailed back home, selling my goods on the way and made a lot of money. Sinbad stopped here and, giving Hindbad some money, told him to come again the next day to have dinner and hear another story. The Second Voyage. I planned not to leave Baghdad again after my voyage, but soon I became bored and wanted to travel again. A few days after I left Baghdad, I fell asleep on an island. When I awoke, the ship was gone. Looking around, I saw something large and white far away. I went to see what it was. While I was looking at it, I saw a huge bird coming. I then remembered the story of the bird called a roc. This huge bird came and sat on the white thing, which was its egg. I then tied myself to the bird's leg within my turban. The next day, the bird flew away, taking me with it. When we stopped, I quickly untied myself. Looking around, this place was not much better than the last one, though there were diamonds everywhere. There were mountains all around, so big that I could not leave. There were also monsters that came out at night. That night, I could not sleep at all. The next morning, I heard a strange sound. Looking out, I saw a piece of meat. Then I remembered the story of the man who tried to get the diamonds by throwing in meat. The diamonds would stick to the meat, and then the rocs would take them back to their nests. The men would then get the diamonds when the rocs finished eating the meat and left. So, filling my pockets with diamonds, I tied myself to a large piece of meat and was taken by a roc to its nest. When a man came to check his nest, he was very surprised. I offered him some of the diamonds and told him my story. Later, I found another ship and returned to Baghdad. Here, Sinbad ended his second story and, again giving Hindbad money, asked him to come the next day. The third voyage. I was soon bored again and so began another voyage. Soon, however, I got into trouble once more. We landed on an island of terrible giants. One of the giants, as tall as a tree and with only one red eye in the middle of his head, liked to eat people. He picked me up and looked me over, but I was too thin for him. He then took our captain, the fattest among us, and ate him. When the giant fell asleep, the rest of us made a plan. We all took sticks and poked out the giant's eye. Then we ran away, but the giant and two others came after us. We tried to get away in several small boats, but they threw rocks at us and killed everybody except the three of us in my boat. We got to a small island. That night, we were sleeping when a huge snake came and swallowed one of my friends. The other two of us ran and climbed a tree, but the snake caught my friend and ate him too. I climbed all the way to the top where the snake couldn't get me. In the morning, when the snake left, I ran to the sea hoping to find a ship. Fortunately, there was one. When I got on, I found the captain to be the same as the one who had left me on the island during my second voyage. He gave me all my things, and on the way back, I again made a lot of money. The fourth voyage. It was not long before I started on another voyage. We had not been gone long when our ship was destroyed by strong winds. Some of us made it to an island where we met some people who seemed friendly. They gave us food, but when I saw that they did not eat, I too did not eat. Soon all my partners ran crazy. Every day they gave us rice to eat. I alone did not eat. I knew they wanted us to get fat so that they could then eat us. This is just what happened. Finally, I was the only one left because I was too thin to eat. After a while, they stopped watching me, so one day I ran away. After many days, I met some friendly people who took me to their king. After I told him my story, he was very good to me. He gave me a beautiful woman for a wife, and we lived happily for some time. Then one day, a friend's wife died. I, at that time, first learned of the custom in that country that if either the wife or the husband dies, the other must also die. This is what happened to my friend. Unfortunately, shortly after, my wife died, and I too was supposed to die. I was given some water and a little food and put down in a deep hole in the mountain to die. I was near death when I heard a noise nearby. I went to see what it was. I couldn't see what made this noise, but I did see a little light very far away. Following the light, I came to an opening in the mountain and made it to the other side. In the distance, I could see a boat to which I called. They sent somebody to get me. After a long voyage, I made more money and returning to Baghdad, gave much of it to the poor. Sinbad then gave Hindbad some more money and asked him to come again the next day. The fifth voyage. For the next voyage, I decided to buy my own ship and be my own captain. Several other merchants came with me. A few days after we left, we found a roc's egg. Even though I told them not to, the others took the young bird from the egg and ate it. Soon, we could see the angry parents flying toward us. They had big rocks that they threw at us, destroying our boat. I alone made it to a nearby island. There, I met an old man who asked me to carry him on my back across the river. This I did, but when I asked him to get up, he refused. He was very strong, and I could not make him get up. The old man slept with his legs around me. Every morning, he would wake me to make me carry him around. One day, I found some grapes, which I made into wine. After drinking the wine, I felt much better and began to sing. The old man wondered what it was that made me so happy. He told me to give him some wine too. He drank too much, so finally I was able to throw him off. I then picked up a large rock and killed him. Happy to be free again, I walked to the sea where I met some other sailors. After telling them my story, we became friends. I went with them to a place where there were many coconuts. To get them, the sailors threw rocks at the monkeys. The monkeys would then get angry and throw coconuts back at the sailors. We took the coconuts and sold them. Eventually, we made enough money that we could return home. Again, having finished his story, Sinbad gave him that money and asked him to come back. The sixth voyage. On my next voyage, the captain one day suddenly cried, "Prepare to die, we are caught in a bad wind." So we took down the sails, the wind and the waves threw our ship against an island and destroyed it. We were not hurt and our goods were not lost, but the place where we landed was impossible to sail out of. Our food slowly ran out. One by one, everybody died until I was the only one left. I was sure that I too was going to die. I decided to go to the river nearby, which disappeared under a mountain. There I decided to make a boat and go down to the river. I might be killed, but I would die anyway even if I didn't try. Fortunately, the river took me to a place with friendly people. There I was again taken to the king to whom I told my story. I also gave him all the goods as a present, but he in turn gave me many much nicer things. After a little while, I wanted to go home. I asked the king for permission. He gave me a letter for our king in which he asked for a friendship. He also gave me a lot of very expensive presents for our king. Soon after arriving in Baghdad, I went to give the letter and gifts to the king. He was very happy. I received many thanks and gifts for my troubles. As usual, having finished his story, Sinbad gave Hindbad some money and asked him to come again the next day. The seventh and final voyage. After the sixth voyage, I had decided to stay home. But my king asked me to make another voyage, so I could not refuse. He wanted me to take a letter and some gifts to the other king in return for those he had received. So I sailed again. The king was very happy when he received the gifts and the letter of thanks from our king. I would have been back in Baghdad shortly after if God had not ordered it otherwise. 3 or 4 days after starting, my boat was attacked. We were all sold as slaves. Fortunately, my master was very kind. My job was to kill elephants for their ivory. One day, after climbing up in the tree from which I usually killed elephants, I saw many of them coming towards me, making a terrible noise. They were all around my tree when one of them picked it up and threw me to the ground. They then took me to a place where there were many elephant bones and lots of ivory. They had taken me there to tell me not to kill them anymore. I soon left to tell my master what I found. When he saw me, he was very happy. I told him my story and showed him the place. He took back a lot of ivory and told me, "You have saved many slaves' lives because many have died killing the elephants. I will now let you go free." After arriving back in Baghdad, I went straight to the king. I told him of my voyage. He was very happy to see me safely back in Baghdad. He gave me many expensive gifts. Since then, I have not left Baghdad, spending all my time with my family and friends. Here, Hindbad went and kissed the hand of Sinbad to show his feelings for him. He now understands the difference between them and why Sinbad was so rich. Giving Hindbad some more money, Sinbad then told him that every day there would be a place for him at the dinner table. The Story of Prince Ahmed and Piribanu. There was once a Sultan of India who had three sons and one niece. The eldest of the princes was called Hussein, the second Ali, the youngest Ahmed, and the princess, his niece, Nuronir. Nuronir's father had died when she was very young, so she had been brought up by the Sultan. When she became a woman, the Sultan began to think about who she should marry. She was very beautiful, and the Sultan wanted a good husband for her. When the Sultan's sons found out what he was planning, they each went to ask for permission to marry the princess. The Sultan loved them all and was afraid that they would be jealous of whomever was chosen. He decided to send them all to different countries to look for something unusual and wonderful that would delight him. Whoever brought back the most unusual and wonderful gift would marry the princess. The sons all agreed to this plan and, dressed as merchants, left the city. The first night, they decided to meet again after 1 year in the same place. In the morning, each ran his own way. Prince Hussein, who had heard of the great power and riches of the kingdom of Bisnagal, went toward the Indian coast. After 3 months, he arrived. The markets there were filled with silks, pottery, jewels, and other goods from every country in the world. One morning, Hussein saw a man crying a small carpet for which he wanted 40 pieces of gold. It wasn't very big and looked quite ordinary. The prince was very surprised at the price. "There must be something," said he, "quite unusual about this carpet." "Oh, there is," answered the man. "Whoever sits on it will be taken immediately wherever he wants to go." The prince was very excited and thought that he had found the very thing that would win the princess. "If what you say is true," said he, "I'll gladly buy it." The man invited the prince to sit on the carpet with him. As soon as Hussein wished to be in his room, they were there. He was very happy and paid the man the 40 pieces of gold plus a little more. Prince Ali, the second brother, joined a caravan and in 4 months arrived in Shiraz, which was then the capital of Persia. On the fourth morning, he saw a man carrying an ivory tube in his hand. He wanted 40 pieces of gold for it. Ali thought he must be crazy. Still, he asked him why the tube was so expensive. "Look through this," said the man, "and you can see whatever you wish to see." Then he handed the tube to Ali. Ali wanted to see his father. He looked through the tube and, to his amazement, could see his father at home looking very healthy. Then he wanted to see Nuronir and instantly saw her laughing with her friends. He immediately bought the magic tube and felt sure that his would be the best of all possible gifts. Prince Ahmed took the road to Samarkand. The day after his arrival, he saw a man with an artificial apple for which he wanted 35 pieces of gold. "Let me see that apple," said the prince. "What's so special about it?" "Sir," answered the man, "this is a great treasure, for it can make any sick person well." While they were talking, a crowd gathered around them. One man said that he had a friend who was dying. They went to the man's house, and as soon as the man had smelled the apple, he became well. Ahmed was sure that neither of his brothers had found anything so unusual and wonderful. He bought the apple and returned to the meeting place with the next caravan. The brothers were all very happy to see each other. They were eager to see what each of the others had found. Hussein started, showing his brothers his flying carpet. Then Prince Ali took out his ivory tube. With this, you can see anything you want, no matter how far away it is. Hussein took it, wanting to see Princess Nurunnihr. Suddenly, he had an awful look on his face. The prince is dying! Then both Prince Ali and Prince Ahmed took the tube and looked. Oh, if only she could smell my apple, said Ahmed, I could save her life. As soon as Ahmed had explained the story of the artificial apple, Hussein told them to get on his carpet. They sat down and instantaneously found themselves beside the princess. Ahmed got up and put the apple to her nose. In a second, she opened her eyes and was completely recovered. When the Sultan heard that they were back and that they'd made the princess well, he was very happy. His sons came to him and each gave him their special gifts, hoping to be chosen to marry the princess. The Sultan of the Indies did not know what to do. I would choose if I could, said he, but Ahmed's apple would not have saved the princess if Ali's tube had not shown you the danger she was in, and if Hussein's carpet had not brought you to her so soon. None of your gifts would have been important without the others. We must, therefore, decide in another way. Get your bows and arrows and meet me outside. Whoever shoots the farthest will marry the princess. Hussein shot first. Ali shot next, and his arrow went far beyond Hussein's. Finally, Ahmed shot, but no one saw where his arrow fell. They searched for it everywhere, but couldn't find it. Ali, therefore, married Princess Nurunnihr. Prince Hussein was very disappointed. He loved the princess so much that he left the court and decided to become a priest. Prince Ahmed was also very disappointed and decided to search for his arrow until he found it. He went out and walked and walked. He walked farther than any man could ever shoot an arrow, but he still couldn't find it. He was about to give up when he finally saw it by some rocks. Nearby was a gate. Ahmed went inside through a dark tunnel. Suddenly, there was a light and he found himself in a magnificent palace. In front of him was the most beautiful woman he'd ever seen. Come near, Prince Ahmed, she said, smiling. You're welcome. Prince Ahmed was surprised to hear this name, but he bowed low. Do not be surprised, she started, for I know all about you. It was I who sold you the apple and sold your brothers the magic carpet and the ivory tube. You see, I am the daughter of a very powerful genie. I've watched you for a long time. I carried your arrow to the place you found it because I thought you deserved more than the Princess Nurunnihr. If you will promise to be true to me, I want to be your wife. With the greatest pleasure, answered the prince. He couldn't believe how lucky he was. Then said the fairy, whose name was Parvaibanu, you are my husband and I am your wife. We need no further ceremony. A huge wedding feast was given, and day after day entertainment was provided, each better than the one before. At the end of 6 months, Prince Ahmed became worried that his father would think that he was dead. Finally, Parvaibanu agreed that Prince Ahmed should go and visit him. But please return quickly, she said, and do not tell him about me. Tell him only that you are happy and ask him to ask no more about it. Prince Ahmed left immediately for his father's court. There he explained how he had found his arrow and met a wonderful person. But he would not explain any more about the mystery. He just said that he was very happy with his new life. Son, said the Sultan, I won't ask you any more about your secret. Your coming has given me more joy than I have felt in a long time. Prince Amet stayed for 3 days and then returned to the fairy Paribanu. After that, he visited his father every month. Each time he was dressed more magnificently than before. Eventually, some of the Sultan's advisors began to worry about how the prince could live so richly. They were jealous and worried that he might become too popular with the people. The Sultan said that he did not believe his advisors, but privately he too was afraid. One day he asked a sorceress to watch Ahmed and find out where he lived. She followed the prince to the rocks, but when he disappeared, she couldn't find where he had gone. The following month, just before Ahmed was expected at his father's court, she went there again. As Prince Ahmed came out of the secret opening, he saw the sorceress on the ground. She was acting like she was sick. He picked her up and took her into his wife. "Prince," the fairy whispered, "this woman is not sick. I think that she has come to give you trouble. But don't worry, I'll take care of her." The prince was not afraid. "I have never hurt anyone, and I can't believe that anyone wants to hurt me," he told the fairy as he left for the Sultan's court. He did not know that the Sultan had become suspicious of him. The sorceress was astonished by everything that she saw. Everywhere there was gold and diamonds and rubies and pearls. Soon, two servants brought her a cup. "Drink this and you'll feel better," said one. "It is the water from the Fountain of Lions." She drank it. In a little while she thanked Paribanu, saying that she now felt fine. Then she left. Though the fairy knew who she was, she wished her a good journey. The sorceress went directly to the surgeon and told him all about the wonderful things she had seen. Then she added, "I'm afraid of what may happen to you. Perhaps the fairy wants to replace you with Prince Ahmed. The situation is very dangerous." The Sultan's advisor suggested that Ahmed should be locked up. The sorceress, however, said that the fairy would become angry if they did that. "A better way," she said, "would be to ask him to prove his love. Ask the prince to bring you a tent, which can be carried in a man's hand, but so large that it can cover your whole army." None of the other advisors had a better idea. So the next day, when the prince came, the Sultan said, "Son, you're very fortunate. You married a rich and wonderful fairy. Won't you please do me a favor?" Then he asked him to bring the tent. The prince was very embarrassed. He didn't know how his father had found out about Paribanu. He also thought that the tent was too much for his father to ask for. Still, he believed that every child should do as its father asks, so he promised to talk to the fairy. Prince Ahmed was very unhappy about having to ask the fairy. He returned to her place earlier than usual, and she saw immediately that something was wrong. Ahmed told her that somehow his father had found out about her. She reminded him about the old woman he had helped and added, "But there must be something else that makes you look so sad." Finally, Prince Ahmed told her about his father's request. She smiled and said that it was nothing. Her treasurer brought a small piece of clothes in his hand. It was so small that when Ahmed saw it, he thought that Paribanu was playing a joke on him. Seeing this in his face, she laughed and said, "What, my prince, do you still doubt me?" Then she had her treasurer set the tent up outside. It could easily hold twice the number of armies Ahmed's father had. The next day, Ahmed took the tent to his father's court. The Sultan was amazed by how the small tent could become so big. He thanked him over and over again, but inside, he felt even more jealous than before. That afternoon, he talked with the sorceress again. She suggested that he ask the prince to bring some water from the Fountain of Lions. That evening, the Sultan asked his son for it. Ahmed couldn't understand why his father was still not satisfied. He was very unhappy about asking his wife for anything more. He returned, however, and told her everything that had happened. The fairy understood that the sorceress was causing all the troubles. But she told the mat that they must continue to show their love for the sultan. The fountain of lions, she explained, is in the court of a great castle. It is guarded by 4 lions. Then she handed him a thread, a bottle, and a sheep. Throw the thread on the ground, and it will roll and lead you to the castle. Take the sheep and cut it into 4 pieces. Throw 1 piece to each of the lions. While they are eating, write quickly and fill the bottle. The next morning, Ahmed did just as the fairy had told him to. He was able to get the water with no trouble. He took it immediately to the sultan's court and handed it to him. Bowing, he said, "Here is the water from the Fountain of Lions that you asked for. But I hope that you remain healthy and will never need to use it." The sultan thanked him, but was still not satisfied. Following the sorceress' advice, he said, "I've just one more thing to ask of you. Bring me a man not more than 1.5 feet tall, whose beard is 30 feet long, and who carries a huge iron bar on his shoulders." The next day, the prince returned to Paribanu. He was very upset. He told her that his father now wanted something impossible. He described the man, adding, "I cannot believe there is such a man in all the world." "Don't worry," said the fairy. "It is not difficult to find this man. He is my brother, Skybar. I will send for him, but be prepared, he is quite strange." She then put a gold dish on the fire and lit some incense in it. Some moments later, there was a thick cloud of smoke and Skybar appeared. He looked at Ahmed with fierce, unfriendly eyes. "Who is this?" he asked. "He is my husband, brother. His name is Ahmed. His father, the Sultan of the Indies, has asked to meet you," she explained. Skybar did not smile, but his eyes were friendlier. "For your husband, I will do anything," he said. The next morning, the prince led Skybar to his father's palace. Skybar was so frightening that everyone who saw him ran and hid in their houses. Skybar went straight up to the sultan when they arrived. "You asked for me?" he asked. "What do you want?" Skybar was so ugly that the sultan couldn't look at him and turned his head away. Skybar was very insulted, and before the prince could stop him, lifted his iron bar and killed the sultan. Then he killed all the people who had given the sultan bad advice, including the sorceress. Skybar made Prince Ahmed the new sultan. The people liked Ahmed very much and were very afraid of Skybar. They all yelled, "Long live Sultan Ahmed!" Prince Ali and the Prince Nuronir were given a large province. They lived there happily for the rest of their lives. Ahmed also wrote to Hussein. He offered him whatever he wanted, but Hussein said he was happy as a priest. He only wanted to be left alone.